You are about to learn the story of Thea Lindauer, a child survivor of the Holocaust. Thea came to America at age 12, but all by herself, to escape Hitler's threat. That was in 1934. When Thea left Germany, her Papa Kahn said to Thea, "There must be an ocean between us." So that's the title of this movie and of Thea's book. This whole movie tells about Thea, and also about all those other child survivors who made it to America, to the Statue of Liberty. But sadly, these children had to come by themselves and left their parents behind. First, you need some background. To start, I will describe a little-known special group within the Holocaust child survivors, the 1,000 children. Thea was a 1,000 child, one of the very first. Next, Thea's story will be set into the general background of place, time, and family. And then, Thea herself will tell her actual story. Many other Jewish children followed in Thea's footsteps. They also came to America unaccompanied, leaving their parents behind, again to escape Hitler. They truly also are child survivors of the Holocaust. They are now called the 1,000 children, sometimes just OTC. I am one myself. I, Claude Kacser, was 6 and a half when, in 1940, I arrived in America, all by myself, also to escape the Hitler threat. That's a photograph of me then. It's my green card. You all remember Kristallnacht, the night of breaking glass, November 9, 10, 1938. That horrendous pogrom against the Jews of Germany and Austria. The British government responded quickly. They passed a bill waiving all immigration and visa requirements for up to 10,000 European Jewish children to flee Hitler and to enter England. But the bill did not include their parents. That became the Kindertransport. It lasted from November 1938 through September 1939. And so that brings us to the 1,000 children. In this program, about 1,400, mainly Jewish children, escaped Hitler's threat by traveling from Europe directly to America during the period 1934 through 1945. We too left our parents behind. Most of these 1,400 never saw their parents again. Thea was lucky. Her parents joined her safely in 1937. My parents were lucky also. We 1,400 are now referred to as the 1,000 children. OTC for short. The OTC story, yet another aspect of the Holocaust rescues, was first recognized through the pioneering work of Iris Posner in the year 2000. Iris asked herself the simple question. Were there any Jewish children who fled Europe to America, who came unaccompanied and leaving their parents behind in Europe? Who helped them? How did they come? When did they come? How many children did come? By 2002, Iris was able to document about 1,000 children who came between 1934 and 1945. Hence our name, the 1,000 children. The number of children Iris has found has now risen to about 1,400. Thea was one of the very first children found by Iris Posner. So was I. Iris soon realized there was no program, or rather, there were many different independent programs, and some that could not be really called programs. She found out that the first OTC came as early as 1934. That's when Thea came with her six shipmates, and the last came as late as 1945. That their ages range from 2 to 16, that's where Iris cut it off. Often several brothers or sisters came together, with the older ones helping to be in charge of the younger ones. Of course, there had to be adult escorts for the OTC kids. Who were they? Who arranged this? Who arranged the whole thing? Iris learned that some of the OTC kids came through arrangements made by various organizations, such as HIAS, which brought Thea, or the American Society of Friends, the Quakers. Some other groups of OTC kids came through the work of individuals, and some individual children came under private family arrangements. In America, they lived with foster parents, in hostels and other group situations, or with relatives already in the United States. One group of 25 kids was hosted by a synagogue. Then they stayed in the synagogue summer camp for 3 years. The English government had waived immigration requirements to help the Kindertransport. But for the 1,000 children, the United States government played no part. No waiver of visa restrictions and quotas. Nothing. Nada. Visas, affidavits, sponsors, hosts, all that had to be attained. The OTC kids came from all over Europe. Before that war, that was not too difficult. But after September 1939, when the war started in Europe, that changed. Jewish families fled, and sometimes older Jewish kids fled by themselves. Some of these became OTC kids. Many of the OTC kids, either with or without their parents, were smuggled, often for payment, over the Pyrenees mountain passes from France to Spain, then to neutral Portugal, and finally, but without their parents, they sailed from Lisbon to America, often on the steamship Serpa Pinto. That's a photograph of her now, and several photos from a Portuguese newspaper reporting on these refugees. The Serpa Pinto is also how many intact Jewish families got out to America. In France, many OTC kids were helped by the Jewish organization Œuvre de Secours des Enfants, OSA. These OSA children often lived in an OSA chateau for months before finally getting to America. As the Germans rounded up Jewish families in France, many of these were transported to and held in the Gurs concentration camp. Sometimes a relief organization was able to get a group of kids out of Gurs, but the parents were not allowed exit. Then the organization would help those kids to get all the way to America. These two were OTC kids. In 2002, Iris Posner, aided only by Leonore Moskowitz, arranged an international conference of the 1,000 children. About 200 kids and some spouses came. Thea presented a brief part of her own story. It was there that Thea was first encouraged to write a book about her story. Later in this movie, she'll be telling you her story. The 2002 1,000 Children Conference is where Thea and I first met, although we had already known and phoned each other as early as the year 2000. The whole conference was amazing. Most important, we kids realized that our individual stories were part of a larger story that had never been told. Many of us had not even thought of ourselves as child survivors of the Holocaust. Thea hadn't. I hadn't. Now something had been added to our self-stories. kids from the same sailing of a ship, who had totally lost contact with each other, now they met again at the same table. And there was a table for OSA kids, and one for the synagogue kids, and so on. Iris had done a wonderful mitzvah, a good deed. The story of these 1,000 children is one of the little-known heroic rescues from the Nazi program to exterminate all Jews. More information and the individual stories of many other 1,000 children can be found at www.1000children.org. Notice that the three words are strung together as one, and that is an org. There's also a book, Don't Wave Goodbye, by Philip Jason and Iris Posner. This contains many children's detailed stories and includes some journals made by children while on Axel transit. It also contains further background information. It is referenced in the previous webpage at www.1000children.org. In the next section, you will learn more about the background and beginning of Thea's story. And then, Thea will tell you the rest herself.
Samuel Kahn was a successful Jewish-German businessman who lived with his family in the small town of Eisenberg in the Rhineland. It was a happy, prosperous town with culture, amenities, and festivals where Jews and Gentiles mingled without concern. Samuel was a respected member of the town council. 12-year-old Thea and her younger sister Ruth enjoyed a rich and carefree life. Then Adolf Hitler came to power in 1933. He had signaled his intentions against Jews much earlier in Mein Kampf. Now he was giving harshly anti-Semitic speeches. But in Eisenberg, most of the Jews said to disregard the speeches and that Hitler would soon disappear. As Thea recalls it, early in 1934, Papa came back from one of his trips. After breakfast, he asked me, "How would you like to go on a real journey, see all of America and have a wonderful education?" I couldn't contain myself. To see all of these wonders, New York City, the beaches of California, of course, I would stay away from Chicago, where there were so many shooting gangsters. Bright golden visions burst into my head. Mama kept calmly shushing me. "Listen to Papa." He went on to explain that he had been invited to a meeting where the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society representative spoke about sending hundreds of young children from Europe to the United States to be adopted and integrated into American families and educated to the best of the family's ability. Never was there a mention of escaping a European Holocaust. My grandfather asked, why can't she go to the relatives in Sweden or France or Luxembourg? I remember Papa standing and saying very calmly, "There must be an ocean between us." In the month that followed, Papa was held up to ridicule. Surely he was a heartless monster who didn't care about his young child living among strangers. A doomsayer who didn't know all that Hitler would do for the Jews. Then the 12-year-old Thea did go to America. As conditions deteriorated in Germany, she attended the best of schools, living with a wealthy Chicago family perched at the top of Chicago society. Half of this book consists of the letters from the Kahn family to Thea over the next 3 years until they were able to escape Germany. This is balanced with Thea's descriptions of the context of what was going on both in America and Germany, including her emotions and feelings, along with enough headlines to provide historical perspective. Now here is Thea introducing and reading excerpts from her book, There Must Be an Ocean Between Us.
Hello, I'm delighted to be here with you through this miracle called electronics. And I hope it will convey all I want you to know. This book if I may say so, was never meant to be written. All I wanted to do was translate some letters that my father wrote me when I was 12 years old and came to this country as part of an experiment in education, and submitted to a committee that was researching at Harvard into children that were brought out of Europe in the early 30s. Now, when I said the book wasn't meant to be written, I meant just that. They looked at the letters that were translated and said, oh, you've got to flesh them out into a manuscript. And that's all I remember, because professors have a way of nudging you into doing something you might not necessarily want to do. Anyway, the book was written, and how it came about, that you have to find out at another date. But I want to read you from the beginning something called Observations, which I made at the beginning of the book. I was almost afraid to reread these letters, much less translate them. So much had happened since then in the lives of all those concerned, my own in particular. Reading them with the eyes of a 12-year-old who would exclaim, thank goodness they're all right. Gott sei Dank, gesundheitlich alles geht gut, which of course is the original German. I would then continue with the joyous life of a young girl being educated in the best way possible. I realize there are limitations, the family's anxieties, the senses watchful eye. Those who look for real political significance will be disappointed. After all, how much of a world politics will an anxious father discuss with his 12-year-old daughter an ocean away under the sight of censors? What I can present to you are the feelings that came with these letters in the aftermath of the trauma not experienced the first time around. This is not your usual Holocaust story of separation, suffering, deprivation, and indescribable tragedy. Nevertheless, it too has the reality of separation, fear, and uncertainty, even in cared-for circumstances. After the discoveries of the horror of the Holocaust, there were many guilt feelings about being among the chosen few. That is what made the obligation to excel much more demanding on me. Why me? I wasn't particularly religious. I didn't have the social consciousness that some children possess at a very early age. I did not have this all aforesaid. Still, all these things developed when I became aware of the difference between me and the children in the same privileged strata of society, children who took their enormous privileges so much for granted. I felt constantly shifted from a pampered child to one with the weight of the world on her shoulders. Strangely enough, this split in personality did not reflect in my schoolwork. And so, let me begin. I do want to give you a little bit the process of the book. As said before, the letters were translated from the old German script and fleshed out. The fleshed out are the comments that the professors suggested. It's not a historical document, but what I did was follow their directions. They were the historians. And they suggested that when a certain letter was written, what was I doing growing up in the United States? So you'll have this back and forth dialogue, more or less, between the letters, the advice of my father, and my comments of what was happening to me. What I'd like to do is start off with the first letter and give you one in between, and then end with the one very prophetically, which the last one was written on November 11th, which is a day of peace to the world, of 1937. So let me begin November 1934. One of the things we included for those who are not historically knowledgeable is the headlines of that particular month, so they could keep up with some sense of reality about the period. And the headlines in November 1934 were, in Germany, Karl Barth, leading German professor, suspended from the university for refusing to take Hitler's loyalty oath. In Great Britain, Winston Churchill warns House of Commons of German air power. In Germany again, Nazis order new music to replace Jewish composer Felix Mendelssohn's score for Midsummer Night's Dream. So that sort of sets the scene for those who believe in headlines and not necessarily are historically in the know. Now, what we have here is the first letter, November 1934. Dear little Thea, this is the first of what I hope will be a steady stream of wonderful letters between us. We await your first letter most anxiously. Just remember, if writing is at present our only link to you, as the telephone calls abroad are so closely monitored, even the most innocent ones are regarded with suspicion. You looked so eager, so excited, and small, waving your goodbyes. I wish I had thought of taking pictures, as some of the others did. What awaits you in the United States of America, we cannot say. We can only hope that wherever you go, people are waiting you eagerly and will be kind to you. I have the fullest confidence you will not disappoint them. This is my fervent hope in our shadowy future, along with my desires to have you safe. The card you sent from New York mentioned being seasick and in the infirmary all the way across. Please explain. Apparently you were in New York a very short time before you took off for Chicago. You must miss the other six in your shipment. You were destined for the Midwest. There are so many questions that we need to have answered, but we know sooner or later you will put our minds at ease. Mama and Ruth and I are very sad that you left us, but we all know it's for the very best of reason, your education in a free world. Both your old teachers, Herr Steuer, as well as the new one, Herr Schaefer, hope you will not forget them. They feel very much part of your life, preparing you for a wonderful future in the new land. In today's Germany, for any teacher to feel that way about a Jewish child is rare indeed. Dear little Thea, I wonder if you know the great responsibility we all have placed on your shoulders. I hope it's not too heavy a burden for you to carry. Your loving Papa. Now, my answer to this is that time in my memory. Papa was right. There was a first stream of letters that crossed the ocean between us until 1937 when they emigrated. My emotions were very mixed, as they had been ever since we left Eisenberg amidst tearful goodbyes at the railroad station. My schoolmates and teachers, my sister Gerda, and of course Papa, who was to accompany me to Hamburg, were gathered around me in that bleak November afternoon. Mama and Ruth chose to stay at home. At the last moment, as we embraced, Mama placed a new shaddai, that's a Jewish good luck amulet, around my neck and handed me two letters. They were from a boy I had met in Erlenbach the last summer vacation, the same boy who had written me at the end of summer. And at that time, it was a letter marked private, a letter Mama had made me read to her and the postman delivering it. And I read with both of them standing there watching me. That was a humiliation. After reading it, I tore it up with tears in my eyes and threw it into the fire and stormed out of the room. Storming out of a room, I might say, was a favorite habit of mine. I didn't want to do that, but Mama made me so angry and what I thought was an intrusion of my privacy. It was a beautiful letter, a poem by Heinrich Heine, and reminiscences of a lovely summer for a romantically innocent 12-year-old. I never answered it. I wish I had. I remember bursting out of the room crying. Things were never as trusting between Mama and me again until now. She sighed as she handed me the new letters with tears in her eyes. I looked at them sadly and tucked them into my handbag. No more words were said. We embraced again, clasping each other tightly, and I was gone. At the railroad station, my friends and teachers waited with a bouquet of red roses. Now, getting roses in November in Germany was quite a tribute and a wonderful compliment. Tears and sobs were all around us, along with whispered goodbyes, write, be well, think of us, nothing about what awaited me in the future. This wasn't like going to my aunt's for a summer vacation or a semester away at school the way I had been. This was going into an uncertain future of a totally new life. The trip to Hamburg was strangely quiet. My thoughts were all on what was ahead, with hopes of landing on the West Coast in California where my half-sister Elsie was employed. Once in a while, Papa would come up with some heavy advice, such as writing to everyone, the obligation to my future foster parents, a formidable task. My mind was teeming with thoughts about all the many things that were coming into my future. We had to be at the ship at 10 a.m. the next morning to meet our escort and the other children. There were to be 7 of us. I, as the youngest, was the only one with parental accompaniment. I didn't remember any further significant words of goodbye, only the threefold biblical blessing with Papa's hand upon my head and the reminder of my responsibilities. Nothing, no spoken word about it being possibly the last time I would see him. He stayed at the dock and waved until I could see him no longer. If Papa was aware of the fact that I looked so small, I was not conscious of it. I felt like the giant Gulliver. I only sensed the great adventure that lay ahead of me. I've read you the first letter that my father wrote and the comments I made. I want to go to a middle letter, meaning in the period of when this correspondence took place. And I did not read you the headlines. Remember, we talked about the headlines that precede each chapter. But I am going to read you the headlines of June 1936. The headlines of the day were, in Rome, Italy conquers Ethiopia. Italy at last has her empire, boasts Mussolini. In Germany, historian Oswald Spengler dies in exile, rejected Nazi racial theories. In Madrid, 36 churches burned in 48 hours. Berlin, Hitler named the head of the Reich police. New York, German boxer Max Schmeling KOs Joe Louis in 12 rounds. Philadelphia, FDR and John Garner nominated on the Democratic presidential ticket. Now those were the world headlines of that day. Now what I'll read to you is a letter that my dad sent on June 30th, 1936. Dear daughter Thea, today's mail was quite heavy with questions about how to get the children out of the country. It is hard to answer them since you wrote that the people in Congress are no longer supportive of the program and that the bill admitting 20,000 children to the United States was turned down. I don't understand it. The need is more urgent now than it was when you left. I will write the committee in Berlin about starting it up again to get more children to safety. We still have not received the big portrait you promised. Elsie also writes that she hasn't heard from you. Is something wrong? You wrote about falling off the horse. Is everything all right? Mrs. Perlstein's note reassured us considerably as to your injury. You have your long summer vacation ahead, presumably a cam again. Be careful that you don't overdo it. I know you're very competitive, but some indoor activities would also be beneficial. All of Germany is spruced up for the Olympic Games, with athletes from all over the world. The big talk is about an American Negro runner, Jesse Owens, who is supposed to be the fastest man on earth. We all hope he will prove that. It would really put an end to the Nazi super race theory. We keep hoping for miracles. Sad to say, there are so few these days. My friend, the pastor, admits there's very little Christian teaching and preaching these days. Even Pastor Niemöller has become disillusioned. I might mention here, Pastor Niemöller was the spokesman for the Lutheran Church, the Protestant Church in Germany. Anyway, so much for observing worldly philosophy. I hope someday you will understand it all and add to the betterment of the world. Ruth, as a child, she has so much to cope with. We're so proud of her. Have a wonderful summer. We will be writing and hope you will too. Your ever affectionate family and dad. You might notice he now doesn't call himself Papa. He calls himself Dad. And he no longer calls me Thea Shen, which is diminutive for little Thea. He now calls me the full adult name. So that is a step forward. Anyway, these are my comments on it. Dad's reference to the Olympic competitor Jesse Owens was certainly exciting news, which all the U.S. newspapers took full advantage of. Dad assessed the situation correctly. It would put an end to the claim of German super race mentality. America was able to send some Jewish athletes by pressuring the German government, but as mentioned before, none of the German Jewish sports clubs were allowed to participate. I'm particularly aware of it because I found out later the man I married was supposed to be in competition for the 400-meter race, and they would not accept him. So, anyway, Papa mentioned of Pastor Niemöller. It referred to the remarks he finally made in his resistance to the Nazi government. They came for the communists, he said, but I was not a communist, so I did not speak. They came for the labor unionists, but I was not a unionist, so I did not speak. They came for the Jews, but I was not a Jew, and so I did not speak. And then they came for me, and there was no one to speak for me. He counts among the righteous Gentiles who spoke out and did not parrot the Nazi doctrine of racial superiority and the total admission of the Old Testament from the present-day Protestant belief in Germany. This is what alerted so many Christian groups as to the state of the religion that was to prevail during Hitler's time. I'll now read you the last letter. There's a lot in between, but you're going to have to find it out for yourself. Anyway, what we have is a letter written on November 11th, 1937, which is sort of significant, I think, the Day of Peace. So here's the letter. My dear daughter Thea, today is what you call Armistice Day, a day when everyone was glad the Great World War was over. For Germany, it was a humiliation and the beginning of what was to come, the Third Reich. I started my life over again then, as I will start over again now. Everything is all in God's directed way. Our papers are in order, as we are the all-important entrance visa for which we waited so long. I can now write our own sailing tickets. We shall leave here in a week, so this will probably be the last letter I will write you. It's been a long 3 years for us. More pain than joy, but for you, thankfully, the other way around. Now, we can go and be at peace. I hope you will not be disappointed in the change in us. Your carefree parents do not exist anymore. We have, however, become more resolute to put the past behind us. So here we are, ready to ship out on November 18th on the SS New York. We should reach New York City about the 28th of November, and after a few days in that city, shall be in Chicago in early December. As much as I try to project, I cannot really picture our reunion. I leave that in the hands of God. Until then, as we have always been, your devoted family, your dad, your papa. Now, that time in my memory, it seems singularly appropriate that this last letter of Papa's should be dated November 11th, the day that brought peace to the world after the First World War, but at the same time laid the social and economic foundations for the Second World War. That date had brought peace to the nation of 1918, and now brought peace to my family as they began their exodus to a new land and a new life. It is hard to describe the laughter, the tears, the embraces that took place at our first meeting. It was the beginning of another phase in my rich, diversified life. The main thing was we were together again. Of course, my parents had aged and seemed much smaller than I remembered them. Ruth was now the same age as I was when I left Germany. Whatever happened now would be in safety and peace. The nightmare years were over. Still, the thought of those left behind still caused anxiety. One of my aunts and family, by crossing the Rhine to stay with relatives, ended up in a Polish concentration camp and perished. Had they remained in their home in the Palatinate, they would have been interned in France and could have survived. Uncle Herman and his family died in the first bombing of Amsterdam. I would have been with them. Who is to say? I brought Papa to New Trier, that was the high school that I had gone to show him how he had come a full circle, and gave Mr. Gaffney, the principal, a replica of Porta Negra, the symbol of Old Trier, which is where my father was born. So it was a full cycle, and I was content.
But that's you were going through, I mean, I to go over there by yourself like that.
I know, that's why, Mike, I get very, very upset. I want to kick people when I hear them say, oh, then you didn't suffer very much. Mm-hmm. As if suffering can be measured by, well, one says, well, you don't have a mark on your arm. You know, they expected to see numbers tattooed. I don't. Mm. I didn't go through that. But what made him think I didn't go through emotional upheaval? I was in the hospital 3 times with anxiety attacks. But you don't, you know, I don't feel I have to justify. But
you don't.
Somehow it's almost an automatic reaction to want to say, damn it, I did, you know. But you can't do that to an audience. I have to remind you of a saying that Mr. Hitler always had. Do you remember this?
He always said, people like us are condemned to perish on the dung heap of history. I remember that phrase, dung heap, not even ash heap, the dung heap of history. Well, I want to read you what happened to someone who didn't perish on the dung heap of history. I, as one of the thousand children, that is what we were called by the various authorities. Instead of Kindertransport, we became the thousand children. As one of the thousand children, I married a fellow refugee, one of General George S. Patton's sassy young lieutenants, a career officer who rose to the rank of colonel in the U.S. Army, and after the war was presented with the highest German honor for his effort in reconciliation between Germany and its former Jewish citizen. As one of the thousand children, I raised a son, David, who received an Army ROTC scholarship to Georgetown University School of Foreign Service, became an Army paratrooper, and now works in Washington, D.C., contractor overseeing defense plans and budget. He has two sons, Charles and Michael. As one of the thousand children, I raised a daughter, Marion Joan, who married Bill Gregory, a U.S. Naval Academy graduate, and has three daughters. The oldest, Kristen Gregory Honeycutt, is an elementary school teacher. The middle daughter, Leslie Gregory Vodcha, graduated from the U.S. Naval Academy 30 years after her father and was selected to participate in the Uniformed Service University for Health Service Medical School in Bethesda. She is currently on active duty with the U.S. Air Force as a doctor, along with her husband, Captain Chris Vodcha. The youngest daughter, Sarah Gregory, has just graduated as a midshipman from the U.S. Naval Academy. As one of the thousand children, I raised another daughter, Robin, an occupational therapist who married to Timothy Lang in a small interfaith chapel that I designed and helped establish at the U.S. Naval Academy. She explains the ritual of Jewish holidays to her three children at her three children's Catholic parochial school. Her children, Rebecca, Catherine, and Teresa, are still in school, in college, and in middle school. As one of the thousand children, I was selected as one of the 100 women of achievement in Maryland for the contribution to the arts in the year 1998. As one of the thousand children, I received the Anne Arundel County, Maryland 2006 Award for Life Achievement in the arts. As one of the thousand children, I am content. Somebody who was supposed to end up on the dung heap of history. Mm-hmm. So, thank you. And Papa, I remain at this time your ever-loving, ever-admiring, ever-grateful daughter, Thea. Thank you.